Hi, welcome to Artistic Adventures. I'm Holly from BB Library, and today we have one of the most intriguing artists that we've done. The work is interesting and it's fun, and probably the most fun I ever had doing art with groups of kids has been doing his work, and that is Jackson Pollack. Just the book that I chose is takes place during one period of time while he was working on one painting. So I just want to give you just a little bit of background, and today I'm going to try putting a side-by-side slides up for the artwork. I think you might be able to see that better. So he was born in 1912 in Wyoming, but school was definitely not his thing. He was very rebellious. He got kicked out of school, and the art teacher saw the potential in him and went to the principal and said, even though we're not going to allow him to graduate from high school, could he still come and take classes in art and sculpture? And recognizing the talent, they said yes. So he didn't graduate from high school, but at 18, he decided that he wanted to move to New York City. And he had an artist in particular that he was in love with, and his name was Thomas Hart Benson. And I'm going to put a picture up next to him. He was a muralist. He made huge paintings on walls of buildings or inside lobbies of buildings, huge paintings. And the thing that Pollack liked about it was that feeling of kind of energy and action. I've got a couple of, the first one up is a piece of work that's called The History of Water. And this was a mural, it was huge. And if you look at it down in the bottom, you see there's a Native American who is kind of getting water from a stream, and then you see people using pumps and then faucets, all the way up to a group of people sitting in a club, and they're having drinks that are made with water. And this dates from 1933, and it was put in a drugstore in Washington, D.C. is where it ended up as a work of art. And this next one is very, very, very typical of the 1930s. This was done 1930 to 1931. He worked on this mural. And this one is called America Today. And it was put at one of the new schools, the New School for Social Research in New York City, which is a college. The new school still stands today. And it's a group of colleges, each having like a particular subject that they focus on. This one reminds me, I grew up in Michigan, and in the Detroit area, there are tons of these murals around. I don't know of any of them being Thomas Hart Benson, but that kind of celebrate, America's industrial, kind of, all the manufacturing that went on during that time. So Pollack ended up going there and working with him. But during this time, the 1930s was a very hard time, The stock market crashed. There was a run on the banks, which meant people came and took money out because the banks were failing. People lost lots and lots of money, and people lost lots and lots of jobs. So it was a hard time. And what the government under President Roosevelt did was decided to start having the government hire some people to work, or hiring a lot of people to work. There was like the Civilian Conservation Corps, that group went around and they helped really develop the national parks. And there was the Works Progress Administration that did everything from building like the highways that we have to doing all sorts of work. But one part of it, they hired artists, a lot of artists, to come and to paint about the American experience and to paint lots of murals. And because Pollack had learned working from Hart Benson, how to do, work on these big scales, he was hired by that. He didn't make much money, but he never really had much, so this was a solid job for him. And two of the paintings that he did, I found, they specialized in murals, but also in just pictures of the American landscape. And this first one comes from the early 1930s, and it's just called Harbor and Lighthouse. And you can see that it's really kind of a pretty landscape of a seaside, and that's one. And then the other one I have that I found from that period of time, it is from 1936, and it's Pennsylvania landscape. So it is just another landscape of like a rural area in America. And so he worked for the WPA, the Works Progress Administration, the government, for a while, and he painted a lot of scenes, but he also spent a lot of time in museums and looking at other pieces of art. And one thing, I'm going to put up a picture that he saw that really affected him, was some seeing a Navajo sand painter. A lot of places, he was very, very, fell in love with the work of Native Americans, as well as people in Asia. He fell in love with their work. And I'm going to put up a picture of a Navajo sand painting going on. They're really elaborate, beautiful paintings made of sand. But what really impressed Pollack was that once they were done, they were destroyed. They weren't put up on a wall, they weren't photographed, they were just destroyed. And the reason for that is, to the Navajo, it was part of a ceremony of healing. And so when they got done with the healing, they destroyed that. And in a way, it made sure that the healing happened. But also, that was something that he saw in traditions in Asia. The Buddhists do these elaborate, also, works in sand and stone. They make these beautiful things, and as soon as they're done, they destroy them for a different reason. They believe that life is always changing, that nothing stays the same, and that is an example that you work really hard on something, but it could be gone. You know, it's like us. You think about it. We change every day. We're not the same person that we were when we got up yesterday morning, and that was just a principle. And those sort of ideas were things that Pollack really liked. And but also at that same time, he was looking at different types of painting. So I've got just a couple that come before the work that we really know him for. He experimented. I have some things. They remind me of some of the works that, some of the cubists and the abstract painting. I have them. The next one I'm putting up is called Male and Female. It's from 1942. So at this point, he's working on his own. And these paintings got some attention for him. And so he continued. And the next one I'm putting up is, let me see, what's it called? It is called, Pasiphae, which is a Greek myth, 1943. And this is the mythology of a princess who gave birth to the Minotaur, which is half human, half bull. And so that's what that one represents. And then the last thing I have from this period of time that I'm pulling up is a self-portrait that he did. That's from that same period. Well, during the same time, you know, he was selling his works. He was pretty happy. He met his wife, who was also an artist. Her name was Lee Krasner. And they bought a home on Long Island, New York, that really was pretty basic. It didn't have heat or hot water. And that's how they started out. But he had a barn that he turned into a studio. And at that point in time, he started making the kind of works that he's known for. And that's where our book takes place. Our book takes place in 1947, when he was working on one particular work of art. And in fact, this is kind of going to put it ahead, but I'm going to show you the work of art. A lot of his paintings, he didn't give names but numbers. This one is number one, is what it is. But it's known by another name that I'm not going to tell you when we get in there. And he made these large paintings, as we'll see in the book, not by taking a brush and painting, but by taking a brush and kind of flinging it onto or dripping it onto the canvases. And that's what he's known about. His style is known as abstract. We know what that is because we saw abstract artist earlier. And when an abstract artist draws, they don't draw what they see. They just kind of draw. It represents something, but not really anything in particular. And that way, you can't tell what, if you look at it, you're not going to be sure what the painting's of. Even if you look at the title, sometimes you'll look and you'll say, not sure what that is. So that's the abstract part of it. Expressionism is another type of art that paints your emotions. Use these strong emotions, anger, you know, hatred, jealousy, but also happiness, and it's that sort of thing. And there was a lot of artists, especially at that time in Germany and, you know, over in Europe, that were using that style. And he'd never made any plans for his paintings. He just said, I feel like painting today. And he went out to his barn and just started working. He never thought about, I want this to be a picture of this. It was in the mood to paint. He'd go out and paint. And sometimes he'd start something and it would take, he could do it in an afternoon, or sometimes it would take him, you know, a long time to finish that up till he was satisfied with it. But what he did paint was how he was feeling. So these kind of represent feelings. He was a big fan of jazz. In fact, I'm going to put a little bit of jazz on while we're working today. The rhythms of jazz, and especially he liked music called bebop, and that's, I'll play you some of that so you can hear what it sounds like. And because of the energy in his work and the way that he worked, he wasn't sitting very carefully painting on a canvas. He was flinging, and he was putting his hands and stepping and all this sort of things. He got the name Action Jackson. And that is, Jackson is his first name, Action Jackson. And that is the title of our book. So let's take a look about this one little scene from his life that during the time that he was working on this one of his more famous paintings. Okay, I just realized I gave you the wrong date of when he was working on this painting. It was 1950. So here's the book, Action Jackson by Jan Greenberg and Sandra Gordon, illustrated by Robert Andrew Parker, and it is published by Roaring Book Press. So we thank them for letting us use it. So here's a picture of his house there in Long Island, New York. Very rural area at that time. So it says, some of this account is imagined. We don't know if the sequence of events during the month of May and June 1950, when Jackson Pollack painted Lavender Mist, so that's the other name for number one, was exactly as we've described it. But we have many firsthand reports about the summer when he made so many of his great paintings. The life in Springs, which was the name of the town, the way he dressed, the way he talked and walked, and more important, the way he painted. And on those, we have based our story. So in the afternoon, Jackson Pollack puts on his paint-splattered boots and walks across the yard. Wind blows from Gardner's Bay, bringing the scent of salt marshes and sea lavender. His eyes miss nothing. Sunlight on the tree branches, tangled stalks of blackberry bushes, beetles crawling in the grass underfoot. Caw-caw, the crow he tamed, flies down and lands on his shoulder. His border collie, Jip, runs in circles, demanding a walk across the fields and down a country road to the wide sandy beach. But Jackson turns and keeps on going. The gray, weathered barn used to be filled with rusted machinery, old fishing gear, and broken tools. Now it's his art studio, a place for painting. Some artists put canvas on an easel or hang it on a wall. Not Jackson. He spreads his out like a sheet, smoothing it flat with his large hands. He wants his painting to be big, big as the sky out west where he grew up, flat as the marshland behind his house. Sunlight pokes through the cracks in the boards and flies buzz in dusty studio air. Sliding doors rattle on their frames. He sits, silent, on the floor, staring at the blank canvas. Some artists cover the canvas with a base coat of white paint. Not Jackson. He wants the paint to soak into the surface, leaving bare patches peeking through the stains of color. Some painters use oil paint or watercolor. Not Jackson. He'll use ordinary house paint from the hardware store to make his paintings. Some artists paint pictures of flowers or people or landscapes. Not Jackson. He expresses his thoughts and feelings directly on the canvas, calling it energy and motion made visible. And he sits, surrounded by the cans of enamel, brushes stiff with dried paints, knives, sticks, a spatula, and canvases, waiting. At last he stands. He chooses a stick and dips it into the can of syrupy paint. Slowly he circles the canvas, stepping around the edges, straddling the corners. Black lines form a tangled web. Now he chooses a brush, working toward the middle. Sprays of colors, tan, teal, yellow, and white. An athlete with a paintbrush, he uses his whole body to make the painting. Layers build with each gesture, new colors emerging, blending, and disappearing into the wet surface. He swoops and leaps like a dancer, paint trailing from a brush that doesn't touch the canvas. I want to make it longer. I want to make a longer and longer line. I want to keep going, is a quote from him. Hours go by like minutes. Suddenly he feels exhausted, used up, his inspiration gone. And this is a quote. Things get in the way of the flow, like roots blocking a soil line. He puts down his brush and goes into the house to make supper, his mind filled with thoughts about the wet painting on the studio, back on the studio floor. And that, there he is with his wife, Lee Krasner. The next afternoon, Jackson prowls around the canvas, studying his work. But he doesn't pick up a brush. Instead, he walks the beach past the sandy marshes and the tall spartolina grass that grows in waves in the breeze. He spends hours sitting on a grassy dune watching the gulls. In the barn, the layer of paint dries. Almost a week passes before he dips a brush and begins his dance. What is he thinking? Does he see the sunlit beach, the patterns of waves, the interlacing branches of the trees, the lush summer grass outside his studio? He says, I don't know where my pictures come from. They just come, and the paint flows. Like the Native American sand paintings he saw as a boy out west, he moves around the canvas, coaxing the paint into loops and curves. He quote, on the floor, I am much more at ease. I can walk around, work the four sides, be in the painting. Fireworks splatter of rosy pink, twisting ropes of white, spangles of silver, a lavender glow where pink and blue-black meet. Jackson listens to jazz recordings in the evening. He likes musicians who improvise, inventing their own melodies as they play. While he paints, the notes spin over and over in his memory, swish and swish again. The rhythm of the brush matches the rhythm of the music. If a penny fell out of his pocket, he'd leave it. An insect lands in the wet paint, it's there, there it stays. Nails and tacks become part of the texture. He caresses the surface with sticky paint-stained hands. One, then two, handprints across the canvas. His eyes move up and down, back and forth with light steps. He follows the sweep of his brush. He stops and a pool of paint pauses. Paint, paint, and more paint, dripping, pouring, flinging. The painting has a life of its own. I try to let it come through, he says. Again, he stops. He climbs a ladder to look down at the whole canvas. Every muscle aches, but his eyes, his mind, his heart knows the painting is finished. And there it is. Number one, some people will be shocked when they see what he's created. Some angry, some confused, some excited, some filled with happiness they could hardly explain. But everyone will agree, Jackson Pollack is doing something original, painting in a way that no one has seen before. For the next few days, he and his wife Lee plant the vegetable garden. They drive into town in their Model A Ford. He digs for clams on the beach. On the weekend, friends drop by for a party. It'll take another week for the thick paint to dry. Then Jackson and Lee will tack the canvas to the studio wall. Jackson sits silent, staring at the blank canvas spread out on the floor of the barn, waiting. Soon he will dip his brush into a can of paint, lifting it into the air, high in the air, to begin again. And here is just the information I think I gave you most of. But one thing I found interesting, like the very first book I read, this is one of the few I've seen that have notes of where he got the information. He interviewed Lee Krasner, as well as talked to a lot of friends that lived at the same time and looked at the writing that they wrote about him. So this book was very well researched, even though he says some of it is made up. The quotes that he said, you know, Jackson saying, are things that he actually said in there. So it's a very well-researched book, but it just gives us that one little incident, you know, little time of him painting what is now known more as Lavender Mist than Number One. All right, we're gonna take a look at how to do a painting like Jackson Pollack. I did the beginning of one yesterday. So normally when he would work, he'd work on it over several days and let the paint dry. So I I used three colors in this one. I used black, blue, and green in it, and I splattered, but it's not done yet because normally, I wanted to do another day. I wanted to maybe take a brush to places or put my hands in or do something. So that's a finished one. So we're gonna look at that second. Before that, I'm gonna get myself set up and you can see how I did that. As I say, it's so much fun. And what I've chosen today, I've decided to use orange, green, and white as my base. So the good thing about letting it dry is that, sometimes if you have wet paint, the colors are gonna mix together. And you're gonna get not what you want. You want the colors to be distinct rather than want them all kind of blending together. And I just used poster paints and tempera paints. It's kind of a mix. It doesn't really matter what you use. I've actually done it with watercolors, and there you have to be careful though, because those colors do mix pretty well. But you can really use any washable paint. So I'm gonna get my area set up here, and we'll work on a piece of artwork. Okay. All right, so I've got myself set up. I put a towel back behind in case I splash over there. I've got a towel here. You can use newspaper or anything at all you want. You probably can see that there's paint all over these, so it's what we use for painting anyway. And I have some containers to put paint in, so I've got a couple. So I'm gonna put my paint into my containers. I also got that one's kind of weird. I also have decided to use one brush. You can clean your brushes in between. I'm gonna use one brush for each color. And let's put some white here. And I'm gonna put my orange over on the side. Oops, my orange needs to be opened up. New thing of orange. Okay, so I think I want the green to be the background color, so I'm gonna take the biggest of my brushes. And I probably will need some more paint. You have to get quite a bit of paint, because what you're gonna do is you're gonna take and just kind of fling it. Music on. Let me put on some bebop music. This is Dizzy Gillespie and his band. And the bebop was like experimental. It was like the music equivalent of what Jackson Pollock was doing. So Alexa, play Hot House by Dizzy Gillespie. So we'll just put one on.
Hot House by Dizzy Gillespie from Spotify.
Okay. Hey, go back to my... All right, I'm gonna change colors. Get my music. There we go. There's some. I'm gonna go off now to my orange. I'm gonna get a lot of paint on it, and I just want drips. Which has a little bit of green in it. So I need some more green on this. You can do whatever you want on this. Definitely is not one way to do this at all. Okay. Okay, so I pronounce this stage one done. Here, let's see if I can hold it up so you can see. And I will let that dry. And I'll go back and do something more to it. Well, I'm going to get the other painting, and I'll do some more to that one. So let me just pick up all of painting this painting. Okay, so here is the thing I was working on yesterday. And I wasn't listening to bebop when I was doing it because I hate to say it, don't want to offend anybody, but it's not my favorite kind of music. I was listening to a song while I was working on this, and I decided rather than name this painting number one or number two, because I don't remember how many of these I've done. I know I've done some of these in the past. In fact, I'm going to sit in the chair because I'm done splattering that way. Because the other thing that he would do is he would then put handprints in it, put smears in it. That would be another layer. The song I was listening to had a line in it I really liked. It's called Dancing Barefoot. And there's a line that says that some strange music, and it's, so I'm calling mine some strange music. And so this time I'm actually gonna get messy. Sorry, parents, but this is, I'm gonna take, and I've got some yellow paint. I'm just gonna put some smears of yellow on it. And because my paint has dried, it's not going to make another, not gonna kind of make them blend together. It's gonna put a layer over the top of it. And the colors will look different just because you got colors on top of colors. So I decided that I thought that what this need is yellow to be my Some Strange Music painting. It really, I don't know, I think this is by far my most fun way of doing. So maybe if I had lived in that time, I would have been an abstract expressionist too. I never really realized that till I was working on this. So I am pronouncing this one done the way I like it. And I'm gonna let it dry. I'm gonna let my other one dry too, and I wanted to add to that also. So try some Jackson Pollack art for yourself. I guarantee that it is a lot of fun. It's worth it, parents, to put out a tarp and let your kids do it because it is so much fun. You can stand over it. I didn't really have the room to do that. Stand over and drip down if you get a lot of paint. Please, kids, don't fling it too much that you get it around, but use washable paint. It cleans up. And it's worth it. You get some really great looking, really, really great looking art. So next week's artist, move this up so I can see you. So next week's artist is going to be Alexander Calder, and he was a sculptor. So we're gonna be doing a couple things. We're gonna be kind of challenging our balance as we make a mobile, as well as something he was known for and what the book focuses on was making little characters out of wire. So we'll take a look at that next week. So thank you. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you next week for Alexander Calder. All right. Bye-bye.